Dr. Miko Hughes, Denise Crosby, Jack Greenquist. Come on.
Where's your
manager's
child? I taught you better than that.
Right.
He's been hiding all day. He's been looking for pizza.
So, welcome to Days of the Dead, Indy. It's such fun to see you all here. Last time I met him was in 2020, that super weird convention we had at Days of the Dead, Indy.
Oh.
Yeah.
Back in 2020?
Yeah, July. It was a COVID con.
Oh, COVID con.
Yeah.
I hope we don't say that about this one.
No, it was all done safely and everyone was fine. It was great.
Yeah. We did it. We're here.
Yes. So I would love to know, are you guys horror fans yourselves?
Horror fans?
Yeah. Oh.
I love horror.
I love horror. yes. I mean, certain horror films, you know, I can't do the take off fingers and, you know, sort of thing like that. But I do like a good chilling ghost Satan epic.
I get too scared. But, you know, I when I was a kid, I loved those old Universal horror movies, Frankenstein,
Karloff.
Yeah, Boris Karloff was the best. And I still am such a fan of those. I don't watch so many horror movies these days. Here and there I'll catch one if I hear it's really good. But you know, when you work on them, you kind of know the mechanics. You know the mechanics of the gags with the blood spurts and all of that, and you know the mechanics of the editing. And so I tend to look at them very, you know, I don't get scared, really. I tend to look at them very technically. Oh, how they did that. Oh, the cut came there. That was good, right? Stuff like that. So that's pretty interesting for me, actually. So I don't really get scared because I'm looking at all of that stuff.
I think thrillers are my favorite, but I can enjoy all of them. You know, Saw, the classics. I really want to see Black Phone. I've been hearing good things.
Yes.
I hear it's not necessarily a horror though, but it looks like it. Is it good?
Yeah, it's
so good. Nice. Can't wait.
Yeah. There was a cool movie I saw last week. I think it's on Netflix, called She Will. You guys know that? Malcolm McDowell is in it, and Alice Krieg. It really has some great depth to it, and they get really kind of a revenge witch sort of vibe. Yeah, it's good. Yeah, we like revenge on bad men.
So obviously for you two, because you probably wouldn't remember much. But how did you guys get involved in Pet Sematary? Was it an audition? Was it many auditions?
Okay, it wasn't too many auditions, they thought. I mean, Star Trek was far more, you know, laborious in that department. But so Mary Lambert, who directed Pet Sematary, she and I had were really good friends, and she and I had made some music videos together. She came up through the world in the 80s of music videos, which so many directors, you know, were doing at that point. So she had the opportunity to do this, her first real studio movie with Paramount. And she said, I want you to do this movie with me. And I had a test, I had to do a screen test at the studio. With Dale Midkiff, who, you know, plays Lewis Creed, and one other actor I had to, Jeff Fahey. I had to test with both of them. And Rebecca De Mornay was up for the part as well. So they put Rebecca with Dale and Rebecca with Jeff, and, you know, the four of us tested, and Dale and I ended up getting the part.
audition. I auditioned, but I wasn't very well prepared for it, because I had like a stack of scripts that I had to get through. And at the time, you know, Stephen King movies were kind of looked down on still, right? Except by this small niche crowd, which has grown into you guys. Huge, huge, much more than a niche crowd. But back then, you know, low-budget horror movie, because it was a low-budget film. And so, you know, I had all these like so-called important films that I was auditioning for at the same time, and I had all these scripts to read. So you know, I read the script for Pet Sematary, and then I kind of like just winged it in the audition, which is sometimes the best way to audition.
as we saw yesterday.
Grab
is so great. I had to put myself on tape for a show that's starting next week. And, you know, it was nuts. I could not have done it without Brad's help in my hotel room yesterday, doing this audition, winging it, completely winging it. But it was great. It worked out. So, that's what we're referring to.
So that's what I did. And then I was called back in to meet with Mary, and we chatted about the character and the project. And then I didn't hear anything for a while, and then, you know, then I booked the movie, and that was that. And I'm so glad I did, you know, I'm really glad I did. Yeah.
Did
I,
you have any...
I don't remember.
I know, exactly. I was like, do you even remember how that happened? Did your push mom have a story?
Not particularly. I know I'm sure I auditioned at least once or twice, and that... Usually with kids on films like that, they like to get twins.
Yeah.
Because of labor laws, you can't work kids very long. The younger they are, the less hours they can get on set. So they want twins, they'll have the other twin come halfway through the day so they can get like a full day of work. And thank goodness to Mary Lambert's credit, she really fought for me, apparently. You know, so I hear that she thought she could get more out of me than any of the twins that they saw.
True. Absolutely. I mean, she really took a risk there, you know, and was willing to do the extra heavy lifting that would take to do, because you were so perfect.
Ellen Creed was a twin, right?
Yes. Yeah. Yes. Yeah, Blaze.
But also, look, Miko was the cutest kid on the planet. He was.
Oh, how far have we fallen?
And he always knew his lines. Always.
And we just, oh my God, Mary was so smart in designing the shoot of the film, in eliciting Miko's trust. You know, it was obviously, oh my God, how are we going to get this kid to do this? And how safe is this? Are we going to, like, I was so happy to see this semi-normal human being in front of me as an adult male, you know, many years later. But Mary designed the movie so that, you know, it was almost shot in sequence. You know, the and usually films are because of convenience, are all over the place. You sometimes shoot the end first, the middle last, you know, it's all over, whatever, because due to location things, needs. But she really wanted to, you know, take the time to ensure that Miko felt safe, trusted us. So by the end of the film, and he has all this, you know, craziness happening, it's like, oh, we get to play today! It was all really, really easy stuff, and that was Mary's pure design of that.
Very smart.
Mm-hmm. I just always figured it was, no, do it again.
Well, I kicked you around a few times. You don't remember? Yeah, and Dale would pinch you.
Yeah.
And Fred would like kind of spit on you, but that's okay. Brad licked you a few times. Yeah, Fred would just, if you like sucked in a moment or something, you'd just hawk a big loogie on you.
Like a llama.
A camel. He was like, we called him Camel Gwynn.
Wow, that's from the set.
Trouble in Paradise.
Right. What was it like working with special effects extraordinaire Lance Anderson?
You had a really gooey one.
We had some gooey stuff.
Well, I never met Lance.
Oh, really?
No, I had sent some pictures of myself to him in L.A., and he designed the makeup from there. And his son, David Anderson, who is now, you know, very highly respected makeup artist, applied along with his associate John Blake. And those were long hours, and you know, for me it was like 4 to 5 hours in the makeup chair to put it on, and then another 2 hours to get it off. But that time went by very fast. We were just such there was just practical joke after practical joke in that makeup trailer, and we all got along so well. So you know, it went by fairly quickly. Although at the end of the day, I was really anxious to get all that makeup off. So I never actually met Lance, but I did see they did have pictures of actual. Photographs of people who where there have been car accidents and their skulls have been broken open, and we were on the very light side of that, because to do what actually happened or what we actually saw in those pictures was too much. So what we ended up with in the movie was kind of benign compared to those photographs. That was pretty shocking.
And it looks, it holds up, like it looks great.
Yeah.
Compared to the remake.
the film that will go unspoken. Oh, we had a great, speaking of the remake, so Brad and I decided to go to my little neighborhood theater. We could literally walk to from my house and see it for a midweek matinee. And so Brad came over and we walked to the cinema, and no one is there, you know? It's like 1 o'clock in the afternoon showing on a Tuesday. So, and it's a really one of those fancy schmancy theaters where, you know, you push a button and they bring you wine and, you know, what?
Can I interrupt for one moment?
You're gonna interrupt?
Yeah.
Okay.
One second. So when we are there, okay, yes, we walk into the lobby, and I'm fiddling with the machine to get the tickets, right, making a mess of it, of course, and Denise is standing next to me, and somebody comes over, we didn't know who, probably an usher, and said, can I help you? And I'm like, no, I can figure this out, and he just kind of waited, you know, and Denise is standing there, and she goes like this, she goes, we're here to see Pet Sematary. You know, we were both in the original Pet Sematary. My name's Denise and this is Brad, and we were in the original Pet
Sematary. Hey, you know, if you got it, flaunt it, right?
That's so annoying.
I can't believe you've given away my secret. Okay, so, yeah. And I said, and of course, well, wait, it gets good. Because the guy, who's the manager, comes out and says, oh, well, if you like, I'll close the cinema.
What?
So only you guys, you'll have your own private screening. I said, oh, that would be nice. Thank you. So Brad and I sat in the theater alone, drinking rosé, and watched the movie. And he bolted the doors closed. So we were the only ones in like a, you know, 5-screen theater.
To be fair, it might have been interesting anyway.
Okay, but, you know, it makes a better story.
Can I share my remake viewing story? Because it's really similar.
Okay.
Except for the celebrity part, that's obviously not correct. I went to my neighborhood theater, 4 screens, not fancy now, it was an old vaudeville theater that they turned into a movie theater in my neighborhood in Chicago, and somebody loved it. We walked away, it was raining, it was snowing at the same time, and it was cold. And so we walked to the theater, my husband and I, and we were the only ones there. And again, it was like Tuesday at noon, so that was not unusual. That always happened. That's where we went. And we watched it, and I was just like,
and he's sitting next to me doing this, and I'm like,
were a few really beautiful foggy shots. I will say that. It was really pretty in moments. But the rest of it, I was like, we walked back in the snow and the rain, drenched 20 degrees. I get home. I put in the original. He took a picture of me in my coat, wet hair, putting in the disc.
That's great.
I have to get that taste out of my mouth. That was the only time I saw it. Maybe I need to revisit it. We had to have some distance from it. Maybe I was too close to the original to appreciate it. Or maybe not. You know, I don't know. Yeah. So anyway, that's my story. I have a couple of non-Pet Sematary questions before we turn it over to the audience for y'all, okay? First one is for Denise and Miko. You guys both worked with one of my heroes, the late, great John Ritter. Any stories? Because I love those movies, by the way. Any stories of John?
Probably one of the nicest human beings certainly that I've ever had the privilege of working with. So generous, so kind, funny as hell. And I think one of our best, and we lost him way too soon. I mean, I got to work with him twice, actually, in a Blake Edwards film, Skin Deep, and a movie of the week. Well, a movie, yeah, it was like a television movie. What was it? Do you remember that?
Katie Segal in it, right?
You what?
Katie Segal,
she was the female love interest. And I was like his bartender.
Give me a moment, I'll figure it out. Yours was also a movie of the week. Yeah.
Wow.
But Lethal Vows, right?
That's right. Yeah.
He was a bad guy. It's scary. He's good. Yeah, he's good. He gave good bad guy. Everyone thinks of him as the funny guy, but the few times he got to play sinister, he did it really well because you don't expect it.
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
It's like a random memory. I remember most just how he treated me was. I've worked with, bigger celebrities, I guess, and they've always been nice. They've never been rude in particular, but he treated me like a friend, like really it was just so honest and earnest, and we would joke about movies. I mean, I think if I remember correctly, we would talk about Bowfinger a lot. I think that movie had just come out and we were cracking up about it and just making references, and he was just so fun. He treated me like an adult. He never talked down to me or anything, and he was just a great guy.
The movie of the week, because that was after Skin Deep, so we hadn't seen each other in a couple of years. He was like, oh my God, come in. I was hanging out in his trailer. We were just sitting around, just, between takes, nobody does that. Come into my trailer, unless, they want you to come into their trailer for some other reason. You get the reference. So, we would just hang out and laugh and talk and, talk. It was just great. I was so sad for that to happen.
Yeah.
To lose him.
Tragedy.
Mm-hmm.
Not a negative thing I've ever heard about him ever from anybody before or after. Everyone's like, oh, he was such a great guy after they died, but even before. So anytime I can talk about. Because I think he was the only celebrity that has passed where I actually cried. I got up, I was getting ready to go for my run at like 5 a.m. and I turned on the computer to check my email. That's kind of an old-fashioned sentence now too. No one uses email anymore. And I was like, and I just sat there and I cried. And that's never happened. I'm like, I don't know this guy. What's wrong with me? I'm like, I don't know what's going on.
Yeah, it has great impact on everyone.
And Brad, you produced a Shakespeare festival. It's like 3 weeks long. Is that correct? Now we talked before. I'm a theater nerd. I want to know about that. I want to know why you did that, how you did that, what was the inspiration behind that project?
It was Shakespeare's 400th birthday.
Yeah.
And I work with a theater company in Los Angeles. And here's what we did. It was a festival of scenes, soliloquies, sonnets. And songs from Shakespeare, and we had 84 actors, and I don't remember the number, but we had like 18 directors, 8 producers. It was like insane, and each show only lasted for 3 days, for 1 weekend, And so we put up a show for one weekend, and then the next weekend was a completely different show, different cast, different scenes and songs. And the third weekend was a whole other, completely different show with different songs. We had live music, dancing. It was crazy. It was crazy, but it was like a fundraiser for the theater, and it made a bunch of money because our least full house, which was like 2/3 full, was the first night, and then everybody kept coming back and coming back. And coming back. Wow. So the second and third weeks were sold out. Wow. It was amazing. Yeah. Yeah.
And was this a fundraiser for a specific theater or just a community?
Yeah, it was
in general?
A Pacific Resident Theater. Okay. It was up there for me, yeah, and it was great. It was kind of exhausting.
Of course, of course. Wow. Yeah.
So it was cool. It was fun.
Awesome. Yeah. Okay, audience questions. Raise those hands. Yes, sir.
All right. My question is for Miko, but quick thing, Pascal, you're the most fucking terrifying thing you've ever seen. First of all, and I will literally buy that shirt. Miko. Are the most adorable child actor ever. I'm friendly with Alec Vincent.
Oh, yeah.
And he's probably the second to me.
Oh, wow.
So I feel like, I want to ask, like, is it ever annoying when people are just like, oh my God, you were so cute, because you were actually very talented. Like, there's a lot of things, even in like Kindergarten Cop or like Pet Sematary, like when you fell and when you were little, like, walking, like, that's talent. So is it kind of annoying when people just, like, say you're cute, you were cute when you actually had talent. I'm talking to him, he doesn't care
for
that shit at all.
Yeah.
So how do you feel about that?
I appreciate it. I appreciate what other people like about it, you know. I think I was just really lucky as the coaches and took direction well and was in the right place at the right time, and I'm super thankful for the opportunities that I had, you know. And I appreciate you saying that. Thanks, man.
Anyone else? Yes, I see a hand. I don't see a person. There, stand up and say it loud.
Talking about cute kids.
What was it like behind the scenes?
What was happening?
What was happening?
All kinds of things.
We were fighting each other constantly.
We ate a lot of lobster, okay? There was a little place, so we were all living in different houses and places all around this beautiful town called Hancock, Maine. And there was a little place that is sadly no longer there on the main highway, and it was called Bob the Lobster. And it had a giant, enormous neon red flashing lobster as the road sign. And it became our like hangout. There were pool tables, there was a bar, and we could get the most delicious, fresh lobster for like $5. We ate so much, I actually got sick of lobster. Every day we went to Bob the Lob, and it was really fun. But it was kind of wonderful being away from LA and kind of left alone. We were on our own, you know. So we were in this beautiful, beautiful state of Maine, and in making a movie that was about Maine, that took place in Maine. And so we could really just kind of embody the whole spirit of this film and not have, you know, people breathing down our necks. It was really enchanting. It was really special.
Chance of a Lifetime?
Is that the name of the movie?
I think that's the name of the movie. Or A Chance,
The Chance.
Something along those lines. It was like, it's been like something out of a lifetime's a chance, is I'm pretty sure that was.
Wow, your brain is working much better than mine at this point. It was called Chance of a Lifetime. I'll go with that.
I had nothing better to do. I was a figure skater, so I spent all day and night at the rink, and then I'd come home and watch TV, which I probably should have been sleeping. But I'd just come home and watch TV, so whatever, like, I would program with VCR to record, so I was like a movie of the week person.
There you go.
You know, I did that.
Well, it's paying off well.
Oh, yeah, it brought me so much use in my life. All right, more questions.
We have a story about Fred that, like, really stands out for you guys that, you know, on set or something like that.
Well, I remember, him and I didn't have any scenes together, but we would cross paths a lot. We would have lunch together often. One night, he'd been shooting all night, and it was dawn, and I was coming on, and I'd been in the makeup chair since like 3 a.m, and he was just getting off, and I said, "No, how'd it go, Fred?" And it was the scene where he had to confess to Dale's character that, you know, he thinks that this is all because of him. And he said, "Well, rough night, rough night. I couldn't get there, you know. I wanted these tears, and they just weren't there. We did take after take." And I said to Mary, I said, could we have a few minutes? And she said, sure. And I went away, and I smoked 5 cigarettes and drank 3 cups of coffee and went back, and they were right there.
Just such presence the man had, and he was so open to telling just being vulnerable about his life and his career. He had such a varied, rich, long career. He had gone from, you know, the top of the game to zero, and, you know, reinvented himself all over again. And he didn't make excuses for that. It was just so wonderful to have someone be honest about that. You know, so often people pretend that, you know, they've never had struggles, or especially when they're, you know, they've been famous at some point, and they don't like to admit that went away. And literally, after the Munsters, he could not get arrested and had to basically go back to New York. You know, was living in a beautiful, elegant home, went back to, you know, taking anything he could get, literally on stage in New York. He would just take any part that he could get. And slowly, you know, with the help of certain directors that recognize him, what a genius actor he is. My cousin Vinny, Cotton Club, you know, parts started to come his way again. And, you know, he just, that is a kind of depth of soul that you get when you really have taken that journey. So he was a man of real wisdom and character and kind and an artist. You know, he wrote children's books, which I have one. So he was really beautiful. I feel so privileged to, you know, have worked with him. And he is Judd Crandall. I mean, done. Drop the mic.
Neil. Yep.
It's all over there.
Yes.
I had a question for.
Oh, no. We'll get. I was going to say, she's been so kind.
Question for Denise. So, your scenes with Zelda, they were always terrifying, right up there with The Exorcist for me and my family and sisters. And so we would always talk about Zelda. And then later I would try to break down, like, what is it about that, those scenes that was so scary? One, is that right? And then the other was your performance and talking about how you
that's a loaded question there. You know, Andrew's performance and the design of that character was pretty much all it took for me to, you know, that what actors do, which is, you know, the imaginary if. You know, if I had a sister that looked like that, you know, what is that doing to me right now in this moment? So, I mean, it was all there. You know, it's like the funeral scene of Gage in that moment where the fight happens with my father and my husband and the coffin nearly tips up. I mean, you're just, that gives you everything. You don't have to really sit there and imagine, you know, you're in something so horrific that it just, if you stay open to it and available to it. And that's sort of how it was with Zelda. It was surreal, it was otherworldly, it was haunting, creepy, uncomfortable, and terrifying. And the story that Rachel tells, you know, her husband, you know, is just so moving. And she's so fragile, you know, that was asked of her to be a parent, really, when she was very ill-equipped to do that.
Not just that, but to someone disabled.
Yes, I mean, all of that, you know, it just, Stephen King gives you, you know, this, he gives it all to you right there. So you just have to stay out of the way, you know, as an actor. Because, you know, and that's not always the case. You know, but those scenes are so rich that I could just go there and make myself. And, you know, the trust of the actors, the trust of the director, just getting me, you know, egging me on, allowing me to go there. It's all really good. All stuff that was, you know, right there for me. Yes, thank you. And you know, I seem pretty normal, you know, after the rap.
I don't know about that.
Your eyebrows shot up.
Whatever normal is.
You know, speaking of that, did you guys read a book before you did the movie, and did you read the book after you did the movie? Did you know the source material before you went into it? Because Zelda was really painted much more awful in the book, of course, but you could do more.
I did read the book. I was on location. I remember reading the book. I was shooting a movie in Nashville, and I knew I was going to be doing Pet Sematary soon, so I had the book with me. And I remember I was in a really old hotel in Nashville. And so I was, you know, on the bed reading Pet Sematary, and, you know, and suddenly the closet door in my hotel room went,
and you're the shadow.
And I threw that book across the room and leapt out of my skin. And I don't think I ever looked at it again if there wasn't bright daylight out in the open and, you know, I was with a room full of people.
Yeah, I read it. I read it twice. And I read a number of other Stephen King novels as well, because I've never read a Stephen King novel at the time. I was the one person on the planet who had not read anything by Stephen King. So I read it twice, and then I had it with me on the set. And every scene I shot, I would read that portion of the novel before we shot it, because, you know, in a screenplay you have to be very efficient with how you word things, because every page counts for a minute, and that's how you time things out. So you can't have a lot of description in a screenplay. So, but it was right there in the novel, so I would like catch everything that was not written in the screenplay from the novel. So that was always the last thing I read before doing the first rehearsal and the first shots of the scene. And there were a lot of things that I picked up that I got into my performance that were not laid out in the screenplay, but were in the novel. So yeah, it was very important for me.
I hear it's good.
Well, let me tell you, I read the book when I was 10, and it was my first Stephen King, and been a lifelong fan ever since. But the movie adaptation is probably one of my favorites of his, and that's probably why you were using that as well as the script to do it. But yeah, it's my favorite.
There's this one moment in particular that I remember not being in the script. And that was when Dale and I were in the Pet Sematary, and he crumbles at my feet in tears, and then I ascend. And there was this one line in the novel that said, this Pascal, something like he looked down at him with great compassion. And I thought that was really important before ascending, because it was that was still part of my first scene in the movie, and it was very important that the character was seen by the audience as a guardian angel more than this demon from hell, right? Even though it looked like, you know, a bit of a mess, as you may remember. So that was really important, but the problem was that the photography department needed me to look up to get this illusion of ascending, but I managed to get them both in. You know, he crumbled at my feet, and I got this look in down here, and this look of compassion, and then lifted it up and floated up. And fortunately, they left it in the movie, because often you do these things and it gets cut out, you know. But they left it in. I'm glad they did, because it kind of set up Pascal as a friendly ghost, not a mean ghost. And without that, you would be like, oh, who is this guy? Who is this guy? Should I be scared of him? Is he going to do something mean? You know, and I think that one little gesture went a long way to say, oh, this Pascal is a ray of hope. Whenever Pascal comes into the story, there is hope, which, you know, the audience knows, oh, it's a doomed hope, where nothing's going to save us, but you still get that little lift like, oh, maybe he'll save the day. You know what I mean?
Well, if y'all follow instructions, maybe they'll be better.
Right. Your intentions were good.
Not your fault. They didn't listen to you. Right. You know, I would love the Pet Sematary parody is like, Lewis and Pascal is like a funny comedy. You know?
His guardian angel in the show.
Right. Well, I mean, we just talked to David Naughton last night, and that's kind of what that friendship relationship was. It was like a buddy comedy in the afterlife, in this life, you know? And it's kind of the same thing, except I'll have to take it a step further. All right, in the pink. Yes, in the pink.
My question is for Miko. As a child actor, was it hard for you to learn your lines? How did you go about that?
Just repetition, just over and over. My parents would work with me and just go over the lines until it was second nature. And so that way, on the day when you film, you're just, you know, thinking less about the words and thinking about being in the moment and, you know, reacting and, you know, taking in what's happening around you. The words are just secondary almost.
It's really impressive at such a young age that you were able to just take all that in and just get it back out. That's
thanks.
Awesome.
So, you know, they just named after your character. Do you have any other parents that come to you at conventions and name their child? Because it's not a popular name.
Yeah, at conventions, definitely. There's a gauge behind you right now. I know you have a gauge. I think that there's been at least one other today. Like every call, it's kind of wild. And I never run into them in the wild, you know. It's like, this is the magnet for these conventions. So, and it's not always, there's definitely cons for it. But more often than you might think.
I considered changing my name.
Did you?
Yes. But then you gave me a sour look, and I thought maybe.
I just have to say that my original co-host for the Dolls for our podcast, Heather, she named her son Gage for your character as well.
That's awesome.
Yeah, so I just had to bring that up too, because you killed me if I didn't say something right now.
That's awesome. It's surreal. It always like, blows my mind.
Yeah. Anyone else? Yes.
To say thanks for Pet Sematary, I wondered for each of you, is there a project that you've been involved in that we may not be familiar with that you'd like us to look for and watch?
So later this year, it's been put off for a couple of years, there's a new Nightmare fan film that's kind of like a modern take on their... We haven't made it yet, let's see if it's good. But the Half High Hopes, we really kind of, that time we've taken to prepare, and it looks like it's going to be better than we originally thought, or at least we have better tools at our disposal. So that's finally looking like it's going to be later this year. It's small, it's not probably going to be anything too crazy, but it's for the fans, and I really like the script. So it's been 20 years since I've really acted so things become.
That's going to be called Dylan's New Nightmare film.
Yeah. It'll be a short and then potential to episodic, maybe more. I don't know. Yeah, it's fun. Hoping to leave you wanting more.
Oh,
anybody else?
Oh,
no. Project that you're going to be
Oh, my God. There's all kinds of stuff out there. I don't know if there's, one particular thing I would steer you to. I think while we're talking, though, what could be fun, because we're talking about Mary Lambert, the director, the wonderful director, you could go on YouTube and look at some of her music videos, which are really pretty cool. And, the ones we did together, like we did a Chris Isaac music video, which is really, really cool. And one with Mick Jagger. And where I get to make out with Mick. That was worth it. And we did, our original, how Mary and I first met was we did a Tom Tom Club music video, As Above, So Below, with Judd Nelson. Judd and I just reunited. Mary lives in New York now, but she came back to LA about, two years ago. She did like a little summer break in LA, and so she had this barbecue, and she invited Judd, and I hadn't seen him since the music video. So that was really cool. And yeah, those are fun. Those are really fun to check out, just something different, and kind of see this early part of our relationship together.
Yeah, Denise, it's been a minute since I've watched music videos, like 20 minutes at least. was that one the one with like the chair rose?
Yeah. Yes. Wow. You're good.
Nerd.
You know more about me than I know about me, and that's
hey, diagnosed murder, right?
That is so awesome. She gave me a sort of a montage, a collage of scenes from my episode of Diagnosis. Two episodes. Did I do two episodes? Oh, yeah. I don't know what I'm doing up here, you guys. I mean, you know that now. My secrets are, I was pulling it off so well.
Sorry.
I don't have a clue as to what I'm doing. Yes. Okay, so I did two episodes, apparently, of Diagnosis Murder, and my friend here brought me a collage of stills. It's really cool. Oh, my God. Oh, my. I'll show you later.
Listener of the podcast will know I truly love that show.
Diagnosis
Murder? Yes, honestly, it's not an ironic thing. I really enjoyed the show, and you were in the season one or two before, and then it went through a change with new casting and a whole transition, and then you were in a later episode too.
Wearing that long hair, that wig, mm-hmm. that fall.
Yes.
Oh my God, my hair's like down the
floor. Yes. So, we talked about it a lot actually. I've got my co-host Jamie addicted to it too. I got a box set for Christmas last year and she's binging it.
Whoa.
Yes.
So check out Diagnosis Murder. It's fabulous.
Streaming on Pluto right now.
Two. Apparently I'm in two. So, I might have done three. I don't know. Maybe. You sure I didn't do three?
Positive.
created the series.
Me and Dick were like that. That man, what a treasure.
Yeah, man.
What a treasure.
Yeah. I did this movie, this very low-budget movie called Across the Hall. It's a terrific little movie, but it's got this great little story to it. And I played a porter in this old hotel, and I was kind of the personification of this old hotel. And it's a thriller sort of thing, kind of a postmodern thriller. Danny Pino was in it, and Brittany Murphy, it was her last movie. Anyway, here's the story. This is a pretty great story. We shot it at Universal on stage 28. Stage 28 was famous because that is where Lon Chaney shot Phantom of the Opera in 1925. And the Opera House set was still standing. And I was like, wow. And we, you know, they built a little set for us in the middle of that. But all of the tiers of the Opera House seats, the box tiers, were still there. And they were like solid. And so you could run around in these places where Lon Chaney had made this amazing movie, Phantom of the Opera. And one of the grips told me this story, and it's not a story that's really, I don't know that it's ever been written down, but he told me it's been passed on from the grips for all these years. And here's the story. The Phantom of the Opera, of course, is a story about an opera house haunted by this phantom, right? And when they finished shooting the Phantom of the Opera, the head of Universal, Carl Laemmle, said, okay, tear down the set. And they started to tear it down, and one morning they found one of the electricians hanging from the rafters by a cable. He had tripped and got caught in a cable, and it broke his neck and he died, right? He was dead. And Carl Laemmle thought, no, it's really haunted. It's really haunted. Do not take down that set. Leave it there. And it stood there from 1925 until, I guess, 2019. It was there. When we shot this movie in 2005 or something like that, it was still there. And Universal wanted to destroy it in order to make room for a new ride in the theme park. And there was a big outcry from film preservationists against this because it was a historic set and it was gorgeous. It was really, really gorgeous. And Universal said, okay, we'll think about this. We'll talk to you about it, blah, blah, blah. And then in the middle of the night, 1 a.m., they brought in the wrecking ball and leveled the whole thing to put in a new ride. So that's kind of a tragic ending, but I was like really, really so jealous to be working in a place where Lon Chaney had worked. I mean, that's amazing. You know, for somebody who likes horror movies, that's like, wow.
It also says something about how far the labor laws have come. Hey, where's Jeff?
I don't know.
Don't worry about it. We got Kevin.
50 years later, he's going to be body hanging.
Oh, Jesus. Oh, man.
Sorry.
Yeah.
All right, I know we got some more out there. I saw them.
Oh, yeah.
Hello.
Hi.
How many of your guys' stunts were you able to do yourself versus someone else?
How many of our what?
Stunts were you able to do versus someone else stunting for you?
Well, the truck hit, I did all myself. The second take. Really good. First one was a two bad.
Have y'all seen that meme with him of him in Pet Sematary and him in New Niner? It says someone keep this kid off the highway.
Yeah. I was always running out on the road.
Wow. Well, my eye healed pretty well after that. It took a couple years.
I had a lot of stuff. I was like hanging in trees. That scene didn't make the final cut. I did a scene of me flying. I was flying down the pathway into the pet cemetery with Lewis. That didn't make it in. I had a number of, I was always being hoisted up and hung like this or that, you know? And I did those all myself, but they didn't make the cut, so I must not have been very good at it.
Good thing you're not an electrician in the 20s.
Where's Brad? Don't worry about Brad. We've got Dennis. But Dennis stepping in for Pascal.
Oh, Brad's the quit. Never mind.
Brad's hanging from the tree.
Was there something in the book that, you know, you thought could add to the creepiness of the movie? Or you were sad that didn't make it in?
Oh, the creepiness. You know, I wasn't concerned with the creepiness.
I don't think
you know. That was up to Mary. Because I think, you know, I just played it as kind of a... You know, my character was there for the camp, really. Because Stephen King's movies, at that time, they all had this campy humor to them. You know, because it wasn't much after things like Creepshow had been made, you know, those early Stephen King movies where there was all this campy humor, and that was part of what the 80s horror movies were like, and that was my job, in part, to have this kind of silly, campy, you know, humor in addition to the, you know, what the character was pursuing, was trying to help everybody. So, creepy never entered my mind. I'll tell you something. On the cover of my script, I had a binder for my script, and on the cover, I had a copy of a picture of an angel sitting beside a child's bed. That's the movie for me. That's the movie that Victor Pascal was in, an angel sitting on the bed of a child. Cool. Nothing creepy about that, actually. But Denise, that's creepy.
Yes, I sort of have a spirit of creep. No. I really believe the script was a really good adaptation of, you know, that book. It really stuck close.
The biggest deviation, I think, of a dead wife and alive.
In the book. Yeah.
That's the biggest one. She was already gone.
Yeah, I mean, because Stephen wrote the screenplay, so you know he's gonna kind of hew towards his book, you know.
Well, unfortunately, a lot of times someone will start writing the screenplay, and then the studio will take it and change it, and then it's not what they wrote, and then that's why authors hate movies.
Right. he wouldn't let them do that. Yeah. It took like, I don't know, 7 years to get this made. Because everybody wanted to change the script.
Yeah.
And he said no, and it's a good thing. It was a solid, solid script.
And he really tried to prevent Pet Sematary 2 from getting made. I mean, it was a debacle, really, and put an end to some relationships. He fought hard, because he you know, in typical Hollywood fashion, oh, Pet Sematary, let's do a sequel. Let's do Pet Sematary 2. And he goes, no, there is no Pet Sematary 2. And they, I don't know how they got away with it, because he really tried to stop it.
I would have loved for him to write a Pet Sematary 2, like he did with Dr. Sleep and The Shining. Yeah, maybe continue Ellie's story. I mean, what happened to that kid, right?
That was always Mary's idea.
Really?
Ellie presumably is alive. I mean, not in the remake. We don't talk about that. But you know, but Mary told me herself that she had many years envisioned Ellie's story would be the sequel. You know, like Ellie's a grown woman now. How did all of this affect her?
Or even as a teenager.
Yeah.
Like 10 years later.
Right.
I would have loved to read that or see that.
Yeah.
Either way.
I
don't know if you guys heard, but I don't know if it's still happening, but I heard maybe a year ago now they're doing a prequel for Paramount Plus, like a show or maybe a feature, I'm not sure.
I heard something about that too.
And it's a prequel following Young Judd.
Oh.
It's kind of interesting.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah.
Yeah. You didn't get much judge past, you know, just that little snippet.
Yeah.
But that's good.
Yeah, it's a lot of work to play.
The things that are not mentioned in the movie are as important as the things that are. That's, you know.
Sure.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Any more up there? All right, I got one more to wrap it up. One of the questions we always ask ourselves when we're reviewing a movie on the Dolls of Horror podcast is, we pick an epic line. Or sometimes we have five favorite line from a movie. First instinct, y'all. Favorite line, not just from Pet Sematary, something you've uttered in any project. Could be theater, movies, shows of your own. Yeah, it could be Pet Sematary if you want it to be, but it doesn't have to be.
Yeah.
Okay, mine is from Pet Sematary. Who said you were dreaming?
Mm-hmm. And how you said it?
Yeah, that was my first shot. That was my first day of shooting, and I liked the way it came out.
It was beautiful.
Yeah.
Well, I think I probably have two from Pet Sematary. I mean, I love the line, "Stop dilly dallying, Lewis." I mean, that's just. Whenever I can use that in my real life, I'll just say, stop dilly-dallying. I also love when Rachel comes back into the kitchen and says, darling. And of course, I have one in Star Trek. I have so many good ones. My next generation one is, are you fully functional? To Dana.
I'm a little terrible. I'll make one.